Hello, welcome. In this video, we will look at geography and environment perspective of the monthly magazine. In this compilation, the first thing is the with regard to the adverse effect caused by the black carbon to the glaciers of the Himalayas and the Himalayan region. Recently, the World Bank released a report titled Glaciers of the Himalayas, Climate Change, Black Carbon and Regional Resilience. This is the report published by the World Bank. What are the key findings published by this report of the World Bank are glaciers in the Himalayan Karakoram and the Hindu Kush mountain ranges are melting faster than the global average ice mass. That means the ice mass which is accumulated in the Himalayan range, Karakoram range and Hindu Kush mountain ranges, this ice mass has been melting faster than the global average ice mass. The rate of retreat in these glaciers is estimated to be 0.3 meters per year. That is 0.3 meters per year the ice has been melting in the western Himalayas. Coming to the eastern Himalayas, it is more, that is the 1 meter per year. This is the situation. For all these things, black carbon deposits produced by the human activity accelerate the pace of this glacier and snow melt in the Himalayan region can be sharply reduced through the strong policies. That means the major cause for the melting of this Himalayan ice mass is the black carbon deposits, which are produced by the human activity. That may be through burning of the so-called fuels and all these things. For this activity, the black carbon has been producing. Black carbon is nothing but it is a part of the PM2.5. That is the particulate matter. It can be reduced. This ice melting can be reduced by using the strong policies of the government. The full implementation of the current policies to mitigate the black carbon can achieve 23% reduction in this ice melting. But incorporating new policies apart from the current policies can incorporate through the regional cooperation among different countries of the Himalayan ranges can achieve enhanced benefits of more than 23%. What are the countries involved here means? Let's see all about this. This is the thing. Himalayan Karakoram and Hindu Kush ranges. Generally, what are the glaciers? Important glaciers are Chengemukpu and Pokalde, Mera, Langta, Kyala, Kungru, Rika Sambai. All these things are the important glaciers. One of the best known glacier for all us is the Gangotri Glacier. And coming to the HKHK mountain range, stands for the Himalayan Karakoram and Hindu Kush mountain ranges. They span over 2,400 kilometers across the six nations, including Afghanistan, Bhutan, in China, Nepal, and Pakistan. Let's say somewhat deeper into the map. When come here, this is the Hindu Kush mountain range in the Afghanistan and the Pakistan areas. And coming to this, this is the Karakoram range in the Ladakh, Jammu, Kashmir, and the upper China range. That is the Siachen glaciers and all these things. And coming to the this is the central Himalayas and eastern Himalayas here. And here lies the Afghanistan, the first country, then Pakistan, second country, India, third country, China, fourth country, Nepal, fifth country, and Bhutan, sixth country. These are the whole countries, six whole countries involving 2,400 kilometers of the Himalayan ranges. They almost account for the 5,500 glaciers in these mountain ranges. Remember, there are nearly 55,000 glaciers are present in these ranges. It is the major fresh water storage apart from the North and South Poles anywhere in the world. These glaciers contain estimated ice reserves of 163 cubic kilometers. Generally, these ice reserves span for 163 cubic kilometers. Almost it feeds 80% of the perennial rivers that flow from the Himalayan ranges, that is including Indus, Ganges and the Brahmaputra, the report says. And snow and the glacier melt from the these ranges play an important role in timing and magnitude of the water availability within the region. This is the state of the situation here. And coming to the other things, these things we already discussed about it. And nothing important other than this. And let's go into our magazine again. Just a minute. Let's go. What is the black carbon? Let's see what all about black carbon. Black carbon is a component of the soot generally emitted by the incomplete combustion of the fossil fuels and the biofuel and the biomass. Remember this thing? It is released by the incomplete combustion of the fossil fuels, that may be some plant materials, that may be some plastic materials, all these things. Incomplete combustion of these fossil fuels, biofuels and biomass also. And chemically, it is component of the fine particulate matter, PM2.5. That's why it is a particulate matter classifying 2.5. And it is a kind of aerosol that is emitted from gas and diesel engines and coal-fired power plants and other sources that burn the fossil fuels, nearly different types of industries and vehicles and coal mining. All these things are the major emission sources of the black carbon. Black carbon particles consist of nearly pure elemental carbon with some levels of oxygen and hydrogen bound into the layered hexagonal structure. When we see the shape of this thing, it is in the somewhat hexagonal structure. It's not hexagonal, it is the diamond. In a hexagonal structure of the black carbon, it's purely elemental carbon with some sorts of oxygen and hydrogen. These are all about the some facts about black carbon. Other than this, it is a short-lived pollutant. It is the second largest contributor for the global warming. The first largest contributor for the global warming is, as we know, carbon dioxide. Unlike other greenhouse gas emissions, black carbon is quickly washed out and can be eliminated from the atmosphere if emissions stop. If the emissions from the different sources have been stopped today, within a few days, this all black carbon will be washed out. This is the thing. That's why some stringent policy measures can be taken out in order to eliminate all these things. It is not the situation like carbon dioxide or methane, which exists in the atmosphere if you remove years and years on by replicating the ions in the atmosphere. But with respect to the black carbon, the situation is somewhat different. It is a localized source with great local importance. When coming to the normal carbon emissions, they are the historical emissions. They are consistently present in the atmosphere. When coming to the black carbon, it is a localized source that can be create great local impact and can be easily eliminated through stringent measures. Black carbon acts in two ways, hastening the pace of glacier melt. How it will melt the glacier in two ways means by decreasing the surface reflectance of the sunlight. When the black carbon is present in the atmosphere or in the near the glaciers, the sunlight coming from the sun can be more absorbed by this so-called glaciers, then in such a situation, the absorption is more. It can create more heat in the glaciers. That's why causing the glacier to melt faster. It will accumulate here. The glacier gets heated due to this sunlight accumulation, due to the presence of the black carbon. That's why decreasing the surface reflectance of the sunlight. If there is no black carbon, then when the sunlight comes here, when the sunlight comes here, it can be comes there and easily get reflected away from it. There is lot of surface reflectance can be seen, and by raising the air temperature, with the presence of more black carbon in the air, the temperature of the air is more. This is the situation. And what is the way forward is reduce the black carbon emissions. First of all, we will eliminate this black carbon by reducing the emissions from the cook stoves, diesel engines, and open burning in the Himalayan ranges. Careful planning and use of hydropower to reflect the changes in the water flows and availability of the water. Careful using of the hydropower and water resources. And third one is the increasing the efficiency of the bricklayers through proven technologies. And fourth one is the knowledge sharing in the region can have the major awareness benefits in this region. And coming to the next thing, that is the National Mission on Biodiversity and Human Well-being. This so-called ambitious plan of National Mission on Biodiversity and Human Well-being in 2018 has been launched in consultation with the Prime Minister's Science and Technology Innovation Advisory Council in consultation with the Ministry of Environment, Forest, Climate Change. These two combined and initiated a policy. That policy is the so-called National Mission on Biodiversity and Human Well-being. The ongoing COVID-19 pandemic shows a significant impact towards the biodiversity and its cyclic effects. That's why it's harsh and more. And about the National Mission on Biodiversity and Human Well-being, that is the NMBHWB, this mission proposes a national effort. It aims to transfer biodiversity science. Generally, what this mission totally talks about means it transforms the science of the biodiversity by linking it to the people's economic prosperity. Only thing is linking of the biodiversity with the economic prosperity of the people. That's all. It aims further India realize its UN SDG goals regarding the India's rich biodiversity to create solutions in the challenges of the agriculture, health, and climate change. Under the mission, various research institutions, government and non-government organizations will work together to catalog, map, assess, and monitor, use the vast resources which are declining in the recent years. These natural assets can be sustainably managed by this collaboration. The mission will also help to create a cadre of biodiversity science professionals. It will create a cadre of biodiversity science professionals cadre to sustain and secure the Indian biodiversity. Finally, this mission hopes to initiate mass movements to engage India's massive population to feel pride in its natural heritage and help in restoring and conserving the nature of the India. This is the main aim and objectives of the National Mission on Biodiversity and Human Well-being. Coming to the benefits that it contributes means it will allow India will emerge as a leader in demonstrating the linkage between the conservation of the natural assets and societal well-being. Generally, we are home to 8% of the global diversity on just 2.3 diversity global land. Just 2.3% of global land can host 8% of biodiversity. That is the India. containing sections of four of the 36 biodiversity hotspots. In total, 36 global biodiversity hotspots of the world. India hosts four of the global biodiversity hotspots. Coming to the agriculture, it rejuvenates agriculture production system, thereby increasing the rural incomes. That's why it will increase the rural incomes and create million of green jobs in restoring the natural tourism and restoration of the biodiversity. It also helps meet its commitments under the new framework on the conservation of the biodiversity or biological diversity, and meet the UN SDG related issues such as poverty alleviation, justice and equality, protection of life. All these things can be managed by improving the biodiversity and the local rural income development. And missions One Health program, which integrate human health with the animal, plant, soil and environment health. Generally, what is the One Health program is? One Health program majorly sees on the integration of the human health with the animal, plant, soil and environment health. Thereby, automatically human health comes under the control. This is the concept of the One Health. Next, coming to the way forward, envisaging One Health approach and a dedicated cadre to meet the enormous environmental challenges of the 21st century and promoting nature-based solutions to the environment challenges regarding the degradation of rivers, forest soils and ongoing threats regarding the climate change. That's why creating goal of climate resilience communities. This is the way forward in this regard. And coming to the next article, that is the Dihing Patkai National Park and Rainmona National Park. To this article, Dihing Patkai National Park and Rainmona National Park. Recently, Assam government created a 422 square kilometers under the Rainmona National Park in the western Assam Kokrajhar district. And Assam government also notified Dihing Patkai as the seventh national park of the state. Dihing Patkai as seventh national park. With this, Assam having seven national parks, coming to the third most having national parks in India. The first is the Madhya Pradesh with 12, Andaman Nicobar Islands 9, and the third is the Assam with the seven national parks. These seven national parks include coming to this east to west, that is the Dibru Saikova National Park, and here is the that is so called Dihang Patkai National Park, and here is the Kaziranga National Park, here is the Nameri National Park and Orang National Park, and here is the Manas National Park. These are the seven national parks of the Assam, almost nearly under the and surroundings of the Brahmaputra River, and Manas only somewhat away from the river. Apart from this, everything under the border of the river only. Coming to the other things, Kaziranga and Manas National Park are the UNESCO World Heritage Site. This is the Manas National Park and Kaziranga. These two are the UNESCO World Heritage Sites. And about the recently proposed Dihing Patkai National Park, it is the larger elephant reserve which spreads across coal and oil rich districts of the Upper Assam, that is the Dibrugarh district and Tinsukia districts of the Assam. Here it is located near the Upper Assam, and the oldest refinery of Asia, that is the Digboi refinery and open cast coal mining at Lido. These two are located nearby this Dihing Patkai National Park only, near this sanctuary. Dihing Patkai Wildlife Sanctuary is also known as Jaipur Rainforest. Its wildlife sanctuary also known as Jaipur Rainforest. And Dihing is the name of the river that flows through this forest. Generally, Here a river flows and joins the Brahmaputra river, that is the Dihing river. Based on that, this name comes. And coming to the Patkai, Patkai is the hill at the foot of this sanctuary lies. Here some hill is there that is named as Patkai. On this foot hills, it is located Dihang Patkai National Park. Based on the two locations, the national park is named. The rare fauna found in this region include Chinese pangolin, flying fox, wild pig, sambar, and barking deer, and gaur, serow, and Malayan giant squirrels. It is the only sanctuary in India which hosts 7 different species of wild cats. What are these 7 different wild cats means? Tiger, leopard, clouded leopard, leopard cat, golden cat, jungle cat, and marbled cat. Remember this thing? Only sanctuary in India which hosts 7 different species of wild cats is the Dihing Patkai National Park, recently proposed by the Assam government. And coming to the next thing, that is the Operation Oliva. This Operation Oliva has been initiated by the Indian Coast Guards in 1980s. From then onwards, year on year, they congregate along Odisha's coast for breeding these olive ridley turtles and nested in the time of November and December. Then these Indian Coast Guards helps their conservation and their maintaining all these things. And olive ridley turtles are the smallest and most abundant of all sea turtles found in the world. And these turtles are the carnivores, generally feed on the meat and get their name from their carapace, which is olive colored. This is the olive colored carapace. And they migrate thousands of kilometers between their feeding and mating grounds. Their feeding grounds in the deep oceans of the Pacific and the Atlantic and Indian Oceans. Their mating stations nearly the coastlines of the Odisha and all these things. From there, they travel thousands of kilometers every year between these two locations. They are best known for their unique mass nesting called Arribada, where thousands of female come together and lay eggs on the same beach. That is called as Arribada in the Odisha. And a habitat they found in the warm waters of Pacific Ocean, Atlantic Ocean, and Indian Oceans. Odisha's Gahir Mata Marine Sanctuary is known as world's largest rookery of the sea turtles. Coming to the protected status of this olive ridley turtles, according to the IUCN red data of the threatened species, it is under the vulnerable list. According to the sites under the Appendix 1, IUCN, International Union for Conservation of Nature and Natural Resources. Coming to the Wildlife Protection of Act of 1972, it's come under Schedule 1. They are extensively poached for their meat, shell, leather, and their eggs. This is the first threat. And coming to the next major threats, the most severe threat is accidental killing through this entanglement in the tall nets or gill nets made for the fishing purposes. Due to the uncontrolled fishing in this mating season of this olive ridley turtles, the accidental killings are more. And ever-increasing debris of plastics, fishing nets, discarded nets, polythene, and other garbage dumped by the tourists and fishing workers here has been another major threat. And coming to the next thing, that is the black soft-shell turtle. This was in news because a major temple in Assam has signed a memorandum of understanding with NGOs named Assam State Jukam Botanical Garden and its district administration for long-term conservation of this rare freshwater black soft-shell turtle, also known as Nilsonia nigricans. Coming to this Nilsonia nigricans, it is a freshwater species. It is among the 29 species of freshwater turtles and tortoises found in India. And they are found in ponds of the temples in northeastern India and Bangladesh. Its distribution ranges from the Brahmaputra River and its tributaries generally here. as we see, the Assam Brahmaputra flows here. These ranges, this turtle exists. And coming to its protection status, it is critically endangered under the UCN, under the sites, under the Appendix 1, and Wildlife Protection Act 1972 provides no legal protection for this. Remember this? They will give under so-called List 1, List 2, and no legal protection. The answer is the only no legal protection. Till now, no protection has been assigned for this species. And coming to the threats, consumption through meats, eggs, and silt mining, so-called sand mining, all these things, encroachment of the wetlands and change in the flooding pattern, all these things have become major threat for this sea turtle. Other sea turtles in the Indian waters are, there are five species of turtles in Indian waters. They are olive ridley turtles and green turtles, loggerhead turtles, hawksbill turtles, and leatherback turtles. Olive ridley and leatherback and loggerhead, these three turtles listed as vulnerable under the IUCN Red List. Hawksbill turtle classified as critically endangered. Remember this, hawksbill is the only turtle classified as critically endangered till now. And green turtle as endangered. Apart from this, all are vulnerable. They are protected in the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972 under Schedule 1. And coming to the next thing, that is the BT cotton. BT cotton, amid the perpetual debate surrounding the BT cotton's positive and negative impacts, a recent study titled Long-Term Impact of BT Cotton, an Empirical Evidence from North India, has said its adoption in the Punjab in the past over a decade has resulted in net economic and environmental benefits. By adopting this so-called BT cotton, they're seeing a lot of environmental and also economic benefits by using this BT cotton. This is the thing they are saying. Coming to the key findings of this publication, since the commercialization of the BT cotton, there has been reduction in the insecticide used by the volume and applications, thereby declining in the environment and human health impact associated with the insecticide and use of the reduction in the expense associated with the insecticide. Generally, what this BT cotton means, this BT cotton seeds itself consists some resistance to the insects. That's why it inbuiltly acts as an insecticide. That is, no needs of other insecticides and pesticides, thereby reducing the use of insecticides and pesticides. Thereby, sustainable environment can be created and human health impacts will be lowered. This is the thing. And as cotton yields in past 13 years have been stable, only exception being 2015. Yet over past 13 years, pesticide use has gradually increased in the BT hybrids and reduced in the non-BT hybrid varieties, primarily driven by the use of the fungicide, which is not applied in the cotton in 2003 and 2004 varieties. Coming to the BT cotton, BT cotton is an insect-resistant transgenic crop designed to combat pink bollworm. This majorly focuses on the insect of pink bollworm. It created by genetically altering the cotton genome and express a microbial protein from the bacteria Bacillus thuringiensis. We all know this. And this transgene, after this hybridization, it inserted into the plant's genome, produced the toxin crystals that the plant would not normally produce. By this gene insertion, it will produce these crystals. When ingested by the certain population of organisms, including the insects, it dissolves the gut of that organism and leading to the organism's death. Here, organism refers to that pink bollworm or other insects. Coming to the next article, that is Atlas of the Glacial Lakes in the Ganga Basin. Recently, Ministry of Jal Shakti has released an updated atlas of glacial lakes that is part of the Ganga River basin. What is the atlas of the glacial lake basin? And all these things we see. About 4,707 glacial lakes have been mapped in the Ganga basin, nearly 4,700 lakes. Last December, a similar inventory of the glacial lakes was prepared for the Indus River basin. The atlas is available on the Bhuvan portal of the NRSC ISRO. This Bhuvan portal generally consists of map related things of the ISRO, maintained by the NRSC of the Hyderabad. And the information of the glacial lakes, including their type, hydrological, topographical, and associated glaciers, useful in identifying the potential critical glacial lakes and consequent GLOF, that is the glacial lake outburst events. Generally, by using this glacial lakes information, there will be useful in identifying critical glacial lake outbursts and all these things, thereby managing all these events in a proper manner. Coming to the glacial lake outburst, generally it refers to a phenomena in which flooding occurs by water dammed by the glacial or a moraine is released suddenly due to the some glacier melts. Generally, remember these things. This is a hill located here. There are the glacials accumulated here in the middle of this. Some of the stones or big stones, all these things accumulated here. Suddenly, due to some disturbance, they fall here. And these glaciers located in the region of this mountain ranges, it will gradually slides away and flows into the remaining lake situated in the foothills of these things. Suddenly, this glacier comes into this lake. By entering into the lake, this glacier, which is ice, melts away. By sustaining this big type of glaciers, this lake suddenly outbursts and flow as flood. That's why a flood can be created. This is called so phenomena of the glacial lake outburst flood. Coming to this, when glaciers melt, this phenomena happens and accumulate behind loose natural glacial moraine dams and made of ice, all these things we have already covered. Unlike earthen dams, the weak structures of the moraine dams lead to abrupt breach on the dam on top of the glacial lake, which could cause flash floods in the downstream areas, which we have seen in the Nanda Devi Glacier recently in the Uttarakhand. And this is all about the geography part of this month. That's all. Thank you.